I will start out by telling you that this is a very personal story. I will probably choke up several times throughout. Don't worry, I'll be fine. It was August 24th. It was a Monday. And it was a normal day. We had a house full of five kids. And in a house full of five kids, you have routines, even during the summer. Days are very busy, but you have to have a routine in order to get things done. Part of my daily routine is to walk the dog in the morning. We have a three-year-old Doberman Pinscher. Her name is Barcelona. She's a fully trained guard dog. And as was my normal tradition, I walked out every single day, took Barcelona out in the back alley behind our house. We live in a row house in Milwaukee. And normally I go out and turn to the left. But when I went out there, I saw that there was a car stalled in the intersection of these two alleys. So I decided, because I know that Barcelona is a very intimidating creature, I decided to go to my right. But I also decided that if that car was still there when I came back, I would put Barcelona in and I would go out and see what was going on, see if I could help. So I went inside, I went around the block, and as I was walking, I could hear this car trying to start. The driver was trying to start the car over and over again. No luck. Now, to my untrained ear, it sounded to me like there was no gas getting to it. So I figured the car was out of gas. I went around the block, Barcelona did her business, took her back in, went and told my wife that I needed to go outside and help this lady. Could she please feed the dog? I went outside and approached the car carefully. We live in a safe neighborhood, but you can never be too careful. Went up and approached the car, knocked on the window, and there I saw, looking at me, was this mother. She's about 20, in her 20s. And I saw this infant, less than a month old, in the car seat next to her, in the front seat, sideways. Most of us know you don't put a baby in the car seat sideways. I asked her if I could help, and she rolled down her window after she rolled down her window, and she said to me, "Yes, I spent the night last night in your alley. My car won't start. I think the battery's dead." It was clear to me the battery wasn't dead because I had heard her cranking it. I said, "Well, we need to get your car pushed out of the way. Is there anyone you can call?" She says, "I've been calling the shelters, and no one can take me and my four kids." I looked at her, and I looked in the back seat, and they're peering at me. I hadn't even noticed. Three little kids staring back at me with a scared look on their face. I said, "Let's push your car out of the way, and then let's see what we can do." So we pushed the car out of the way, and I said, "Do you have anyone that can help you?" She said, "No, I don't have anyone." I had to stop for a second. It was hard for me to imagine for even a moment that this person had no one. I said, "Okay." I said, "Let's push your car out of the way and let me go talk to my wife and see what we can do." I'm kind of a problem solver. My wife will tell you that that's a good thing and a bad thing. I try to solve every problem on earth. Once we pushed the car to a safe spot, I left the mother and her kids and explained everything. And I decided that they should come to the house and relax a bit, get some food and some rest, and then we would decide what to do. The kids were 5 years old, a little bit less than three, a little bit less than two, and less than a one-month-old baby. The baby was less than 7 pounds when we found him. He was born at a birth weight of 7.5 pounds. So in that 1 month, he had lost almost a pound of weight. That's Linaya. I'm sorry, that's Tamaya. She's five. Linaya is three. Kendrick is about two. And then the baby, TJ. Kendrick, that night when we fed him pizza, didn't even know how to eat pizza. He took it like this and rubbed it on his face that way. I'm not kidding. My wife looked at him and I looked at each other and we were like, raised by wolves. We had decided that the car repair was going to be bigger than anything I could do. It wasn't just gas, it turned out to be the fuel pump. And in my younger years, I might have climbed under a car and pulled the gas tank, but I'm too old for that. So I decided we would have the car towed to a mechanic friend of mine, and that we would offer to the mother to put her up in a hotel while we took care of her kids, if she would take us up on that. She said, "I only met you, but for some reason I trust you. I will leave my children with you." To be honest, we were a little bit shocked. So what does this have to do with WordPress? First of all, you can't change the world until a butterfly at least flaps its wings. I'm a big fan of chaos theory. I have to take you back a few years. 2009. A friend of mine and myself had started a Harley liquidation parts business. We sold Harley parts online. I knew nothing about Harley-Davidson motorcycles. I knew they had two wheels, and I knew they made a lot of noise. But my partner, he was an expert. I knew how to get things online. I knew how to sell them. We were busy liquidating Harley parts online, and one day the idea struck me that, hey, there's got to be a way I can make money off of my competitors on eBay. And so the thought of getting involved with the eBay affiliate marketing program came to me, and I said, okay, there's got to be a way I can do this. So I spent a little bit of time researching, and I found this thing called a plugin. I was a little bit intrigued. It was a plugin for WordPress. But WordPress is blogging, I thought. So I got this plugin. I spent the $49. I said, it's $50, I'll give it a try. Within an hour, I had WordPress up and running on a server. I couldn't believe how easy it was to install. Half an hour later, I had the plugin running. And 2 days later, I had a domain. I had WordPress running. I had this plugin running. And 30 days later, I was making money off of my competitors on eBay. It was a little decision. It was a leap of faith. It was $49. But that little leap of faith is what threw me into eBay. I mean, threw me into WordPress. A little bit later, the Harley business closed down. There were a bunch of factors that went into it, bad decisions. I could go into it. It's not important. Unfortunately, my wife, Jessica, had also found out that she was out of a job. Her company literally went belly up overnight. And then to add to it, we discovered that Jessica was pregnant with our second child. So between trying to start a new business and Jessica being out of a job, we went through savings. We actually almost found ourselves homeless in 2010. I decided I was going to make a go of being a WordPress developer. I was pumping out $500 WordPress sites like you wouldn't believe. Out of the box, no customization, no nothing. I threw them out there. I was making an okay living. We were starting to build up a little bit of momentum, a little bit of steam. And then my partner, Greg, called me up. He's an old friend of mine. He wasn't my partner at this particular time. But he said, hey, I'm making a lot more money in WordPress than you are, and I need help. He said, we need to start selling customized WordPress sites. I've been programming since the age of 10. The idea didn't intimidate me. I like the idea of bigger and better projects. And so I decided, yeah, let's go ahead and do it. In 2012, Greg says, hey, you need to come out to WordCamp out in San Diego. Greg is on the West Coast in California. I had no idea what WordCamp was. It sounded like a tech conference. Yuck. He said, I'll tell you what. I will pay for your ticket into WordCamp if you pay for the airline ticket to get out here. I thought, well, that sounds equitable. Tech conferences generally cost a fortune. Ticket to California from Wisconsin is about $300. Sure, I'll do it. So even though I loathe tech conferences, I loathed everything about them, I decided, yeah, let's go ahead and do it. My wife was all on board. She's like, whatever you need to do, just find something you like doing. So I went out to WordCamp San Diego after discovering the price of the ticket, feeling a little bit jilted. I let Greg know that. And then I went to WordCamp San Diego and everything changed. Because that WordCamp was where I actually saw the true potential of WordPress, and it had nothing to do with the software. It actually had to do with the community surrounding it. That was where I discovered that people and a community can grow and people can succeed when you have people that do well for themselves by doing well for others. It was a small decision to go, and it's probably not one I would have made had I known ahead of time what the WordCamp ticket cost, because I wouldn't have felt, you know, to be honest. And some might argue that the decision was made out of ignorance. I would argue that the decision was made out of luck. So sometimes little things are based on a little bit of luck, but they turn into big things later. So how do I get into current day? Good question. I have another story to tell. My wife and I were living in this house. We had moved to Milwaukee. We had moved from northern Wisconsin. We decided we wanted to buy a house in Milwaukee because Milwaukee has a huge problem with homelessness, with children in need, and it's always been a passion of ours to take children in. We wanted to take in sibling groups because sibling groups are the hardest to place. Children taken out of their homes because they have abusive parents are already ripped out of a known that, while it's awful, it's something they know, and it's more comfortable than the unknown. Imagine being pulled out of your house and then being split from your siblings. It's enough to literally drive children crazy, honest to goodness. Sibling groups are also hard to place because nobody wants the 10 or 12-year-old child that's no longer cute anymore. That child has developed his own personality or her own personality. That child has developed independence. That child may have developed things like anger problems. That child has seen way too much for a child that age to have seen. People don't want to take that child in, so they many times don't want to take all of them in. And then it's just a matter of practicality. Most people don't have the room. You take in a sibling group of three or four people, you can't do it if you don't have the room. So in October of 2014, last year, while we were moving into this 115-year-old home, which needed a lot of renovation work, which is still going on, by the way, we knew that our ultimate goal was to build out the attic so that we could take in these kids. We could take in kids that needed room. Our attic was big enough that we could put in a 4-bedroom, 2-bath expansion, and our goal was to do exactly that. So we were putting money into renovations, more money than the house is worth. I believe that a home is far more than a financial investment, and my wife agrees, thank goodness. And we had to put new roof, new plumbing, new electrical, redo the kitchen, all kinds of work being done on this house. This house, by the way, is huge. It's about 4,000 square feet before the attic. But it's laid out kind of weird because it's a home built in 1897. So last year, our goal, like I said, was to build out the attic, but we had kind of run out of money. But in October of last year, my wife gets a message from the mother of one of my son's friends. She said, "I finally have a job, but I have no one to take care of my kids. Can you take my kids for a while?" My wife had never even met the mother, but the son had come over for several play dates, and the son always gave good reports when he went back. She had nowhere to turn either. And my wife and I discussed it for about, 15 minutes. And we said, "We're not ready with the attic, but we'll take them in." So it wasn't according to plan, but it was something we needed to do. So last year in October, we took in Adonis. He's 10. Don't let the smile fool you. This kid came to us with major anger issues. He had an incident in school every single day. We have Nazir, who has learning disabilities. He's about 3. And then we had a 3-month-old baby. By the way, one of the things that I said when I said we're going to take in siblings, I won't take in an infant. I like my sleep. You can see now that I've shown you 2 slides with pictures of kids. Both of them have infants in it. Sometimes you just shouldn't ever say never. So, But because it happened so fast, and I knew that a big life change was coming, late one night I said, I'm going to start a blog. So I said, let's see, what would I call it? How about 2 to 5? We went from 2 kids to 5 kids overnight. Sounds good. So 2to5.us was created. I started blogging that night, late at night. It was truly a decision I made on a whim. But sometimes the big things come from small things built on a whim. It takes a village. We needed space. There is no doubt about it. Adonis was the only one that actually had a room and a bed. Nazir, we had, who's a 3-year-old, we put in next to our bed on one side in a little pink toddler bed that belonged to my daughter Brenna that she had outgrown. Amir slept in a bassinet that we bought on the other side of Jessica's bed, on Jessica's side of the bed. And we knew that that would be okay for a little bit, but at some point in time, these kids were gonna need spaces of their own when they grew up. And so we knew that we needed to get the attic done sooner rather than later, but we were kind of at this point where we were out of money. It was gonna cost us $140,000 to renovate the attic. Because it's in a historic district, there are certain things that we have to do, hardwood floors, things like that. Staircases, which are ridiculously expensive because it needed a second exit. And to be honest, we got a little bit of sticker shock. We had rounded up about $70,000, about half of it. We didn't think it was gonna cost more than that. So a little bit of underestimation there, I guess. But we decided $70,000 was enough to get us started. So we signed a contract in January to have the work done. I decided, you know, I've been a part of the WordPress community for a long time. I've seen what can happen with the power of crowdfunding for really good causes. I myself have donated to many good causes in the WordPress world. I said to my wife, let's try a crowdfund. I don't expect to get the full $70,000. I wouldn't expect it. But there are people who want to give. There are people who want to help. There are people who believe in our cause. Let's see what we can do. So my immediate thought was, let's see if there's a plugin available for this. I looked. In October of last year, there wasn't much that really tripped my trigger. I thought about it and thought about it, thought about the crowdfunding sites. It really bothered me, but I understood why, that every donation, there's a little bit of money that gets taken out. I mean, they have to keep their doors open. I get it. But I also wanted all the money to go towards the cause. I eventually settled on tilt.com because they have a good relationship with the WordPress world. And I ran a campaign, which lasted for 45 days, and we were able to raise about $10,000 through this campaign. Most of that money, 85% of it, came from $10, $20, $30 donations that came from the WordPress community. I was kind of blown away. $10,000 from a little bit of money from a bunch of people, and it added up. I don't want to get political here. But you may have noticed a similar thing going with a gentleman by the name of Bernie Sanders who's managed to raise a bunch of money with small donations. It's amazing what a village can do. And it takes a village of people contributing a little to build up something great. So back to the woman at the beginning of the story, the woman I found in the alley. As I mentioned earlier, Jessica and I immediately had concluded that it was gonna cost us a bit of money. We knew it was gonna cost $1,000 to $1,500 by the time we put her in a hotel, got her car fixed and all that. I had written a blog post about the experience of finding her in the alley. And all of a sudden, through Slack, I'm on several Slack channels, people started asking me what they could do to help. And so, there I was again. Let's look at crowdfunding. Now earlier this year, I was at WordCamp San Diego again, and I got to know the guys at GiveWP really well, Devin Walker and Matt Cromwell. Now, I knew them before a little bit, but I hadn't really talked to them. And it sounded like they had some really good things going back when I was in San Diego, and I thought, well, let me look again, see if I can put this in a plugin. So I downloaded the, I'm having a problem with the clicker. Next slide, please. There we go. I had a backup plan. I installed the GiveWP plugin. I was really impressed with how easy and how intuitive it was. It literally took me 10 minutes to download it and install it. Another 5 minutes to 10 minutes to actually get the campaign going. The only thing that was left for me to do is make sure that the payments worked. And of course, the only way to get a payment is to get people to donate money, right? So, since Twitter is so big in the WordPress community, I tweeted out, hey, we need money. It was simple as that. My blog post was entitled, We Need Money. I was direct, I was to the point. Within an hour, my post had been retweeted, and I had pulled in $1,000 to help this family within an hour. Ultimately, when everything was done, my wife and I had spent about $5,000 between food, clothing, car repairs, hotels. We put her up actually for 2 weeks rather than one, and just a whole bunch of everything, you know, just adding up. We raised $4,800 in that give campaign. $3,500 of that money came from WordPress community people. I had made a small decision to keep it within the WordPress family. We were able to raise a lot of money for a very worthy cause by taking one small thing, by zigging when I normally zag, and through several decisions and experiences through the past few years, I was able to take every aspect of what makes WordPress great and change the world. This is them, probably the third night that they were here. You can see we had a pretty crowded table, but it was always fun. Now for my epilogue here, I'm going to read this story to you. I'm hoping that reading it is easier than actually reciting it, in that when I recite it, I usually just fall down in a ball of tears. I probably will anyway, but I'm gonna give this a shot. So bear with me, I hope you'll indulge me. For her growing up, nothing was ever for free, and that includes kindness. If an adult was being kind to her, one could be certain that there was some sort of price attached to that kindness. Something would be required, expected, demanded of her. She might not have known what or when, but she was sure that it simply would be. If you ask her, she would tell you that she was not even sure how she came to know this little fact of life. It seemed like she was born with this knowledge, and as it turned out, that was a good thing because it was probably quite key to her survival. She was 5 years old or so the first time she could remember it entering foster care. 5 years isn't very old, and yet it was old enough for her to know that she didn't want to leave what she knew for the great unknown. Abuse is terrible, but at least it was a known abuse. But to go off to another place with unknown adults and unknown rules, well, the fear of the unknown was 10 times worse than anything she had known up until that point. Because she and her younger brother were removed on an emergency basis, they didn't immediately go to a family. Instead, they found themselves being left in the care of an elderly lady. Remember, at 5 years old, anyone with gray hair is considered elderly. She lived in this wondrous house with this massively lush, overgrown backyard. Think of it as a cross between Alice in Wonderland and the Secret Garden. The lady wore her hair in a large bun at the nape of her neck. There was wood everywhere, lots of dancing shadows as a result of sunbeams filtering through the trees and windows, food in the pantry and the fridge, and a croquet set in the backyard. It was magical. And yet, the girl was always on her guard, ready and waiting for what must surely be lurking underneath all that magic. Each night, a train would pass nearby and toot its whistle rather loudly. Having grown up with little food, but with an instinct to survive, she and her brother, even at their young ages, were scavengers. As soon as they heard the train whistle, they would scurry out of their bed, and head straight to the kitchen to gorge themselves. After all, the pantry and the fridge had food in it. It was amazing and something they had never experienced before. Like mice, they were hesitant, darting around, eyes on the lookout for signs that Mrs. Elderly Bun had heard them. The first night, they turned out the lights, and there on the table were two slices of chocolate cake and this awesome chocolate icing and two glasses of milk. It was as if they had died and gone to heaven. They wasted no time and downed the cake and milk, running back to their beds faster than you could even say died and gone to heaven. That night, they both laid in their beds with silly sugar-induced smiles, still trying to lick any leftover chocolate from their lips until they drifted off to sleep. Of course, the little girl, being the wiser and older one, knew that nothing came for free. Come morning, there'd be a price to pay, and she was prepared to pay it for both of them. That is, after all, what big sisters do. Yet another piece of knowledge she had, but didn't know how. But the next day, as they quietly made their way out to breakfast, nothing was said. No evidence even existed of the night's indulgence. It was as if it had been a wonderful dream that they had both shared. Trying not to push their luck, they spent the day hiding in the backyard, but eventually night came, and so did another train whistle. She can't tell you how many nights there were, how many trains passed by, or how many slices of cake and glasses of milk magically appeared. But what she will tell you is that at no time did Mrs. Elderly Bun demand payment for her kindness. For the first time in her young, not so innocent life, she had experienced kindness being offered just because. There were no strings attached to those slices of cake or those glasses of milk, nothing lurking underneath the kindness. The woman in the bun knew how scary it was for them to be there. She knew that even though they came from a seriously abusive environment, that they still preferred that known environment over the unknown one they suddenly found themselves thrust into. She knew that they were starving for more than just food, and she did what she could in a way that these children could understand and relate. Even if they were too young to fully grasp the greatness she was sharing with them, the real kindness isn't something you have to pay a price for. It just is. Standing here today, I wish I could tell you that immediately after that experience, life for my wife and her brother changed. I wish I could tell you that they found more trustworthy people during their childhoods than untrustworthy ones. The kindness without strings attached was the constant instead of the exception. I wish I could tell you those things, but I can't. The rest of Jessica's childhood was spent in and out of foster homes, in and out of abusive relationships, and with both family and otherwise, until ultimately she aged out at the age of 18. But through it all, this woman's no-strings-attached kindness stuck with my wife. Jessica had been given a taste of kindness. She knew it existed. And after leaving, she never gave up hope on finding it again. Pardon me. This knowledge she had acquired from something as simple as a piece of chocolate cake has made everything that I've told you possible today. Because if Jessica had not experienced that one simple act of kindness, I probably would have never met her. And if I had, it's likely I wouldn't have liked her. It's certainly likely that I would have never fallen in love with her. Because it was her desire not only to survive, but to thrive that I fell in love with. It was her drive to pass kindness onto others with no strings attached that changed my outlook on life. One little piece of chocolate cake set things in motion that no one could have foreseen. One little piece of chocolate cake turned me from someone who would have likely walked in the other direction when I saw a mother in distress to a person who walked towards the distress and simply asked, "Can I help?" If it had not been for that one little piece of chocolate cake, it's very likely that I would not be here in Portland, Oregon, giving a presentation on how WordPress, or better yet, you, can change lives or change the world. We all hear that everyone in here has the power to change the world. I agree with that, but the problem is, saying that makes it sound like it's an on-off switch. The power to change the world is happening every single moment with every single one of you, even in small amounts. You can't turn that off. What comes with the switch is the power to be deliberate. Take that power. Be deliberate with that power. Make those small decisions. Do what you can with it. Because you never know that piece of chocolate cake might just change the world. My name is Marc, and I thank you for sitting here and listening to me and spending the last few minutes with me.
Let's give a hand to Marc for his talk.
And I made it through without one tissue, which is the first time ever.
Thank you, Marc.